the questions on Chatterbox. We're starting there. Let me just get me here. And we're starting right there. And we go like that. And like that. Got that on camera. Uh-oh. Jesus, how does it do it so quick? It's so incredible how quick it is. Hey, everybody.
The internet for you.
This is our last Periscope, actually, from Florida. The last Q&A, I should say, from Florida. We leave on Friday, actually. Hold on one second there.
Hey, Terry.
Okay. Let me just turn this around. Turn this around. Let me just get it all lined up. Here we go. Awesome. Hey, everybody. Jeff Gellman of Solid Canine Training. How are you? How is everybody? Let's heart us up. This is our very last Periscope from... Let me just turn that down. From the last Q&A, I should say. I'll be on Periscope tomorrow, and I'll be on Periscope Friday morning. But on Monday and Wednesday, we do this Periscope. We do a dog training Q&A, where every Monday and Wednesday, 9 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, you can ask your dog training questions. You will get an answer. You will, if you've got intensive issues, you might need a Skype visit. It might be more, because this is rapid fire. If you're brand new here, welcome. My name is Jeff Gellman. Jeff Gellman of Solid Canine Training, Solid Canine Training. Little character in the corner. Click on the little character in the corner. Share this on Facebook. Share this on Twitter. Invite your friends on both of those platforms and social media. Also, Periscope. What you want to do on Periscope is this. Good evening, Clark. Invite people and then also join me, follow me, and turn on your alerts. Why? You never know when I'm going to do these. I think today is my fourth. Today might be my fourth Periscope, maybe my third Periscope. Either way, I do a lot of these Periscopes. Why? Because I want free content getting out there. I don't want you to turn your dog into the shelter. Oh, my God, Sarah Baker, Kelly Callio, Kyle Elliott, Sarah Baker. Oh, my gosh, you're inviting people.
Okay.
My dogs are in Downstaser Place. This is not a dog demo show. I'm asking your questions. I've got 9 dogs. They're actually all over the place. All right? So, all right, Terry, how are you? All right? So... Don't touch my dog. That was a good one, wasn't it? Share that one around. Spread that one around. Also, if you miss any of my Periscopes, you've got 24 hours to watch them. And if it goes over 24 hours, you can go to my Catch account. My Catch account is on my website. This is my 402nd Periscope. 402nd Periscope. That's a lot of Periscopes. Mm-hmm. All right. So let's get right into your training questions. Wow is right. I know. That's a lot of Periscopes. Okay.
What can I do if my puppy doesn't stop nipping? I have tried the yelping or trying to distract her.
Okay. So this is the thing, Andrea. First of all, how old, Andrea, or Andrea, I apologize for the pronunciation. How old is your dog? How old is your dog? When you say puppy, your puppy might be different than my idea of a puppy. So how old is your dog? People have said their puppies are 18 months old, 3 months old, 12 weeks old. You got a 12 weeks old puppy. This is what I want you to do. I don't want you to distract the dog, because all you're going to do is teach the dog to bite and then go and bite something else. You need to correct the dog. This is what I would do. My first go-to is this. Yes, they have good and bad. Every dog has got good and bad days, just like we have good and bad days, right? Take your thumb, the dog nips really quickly, stealth-like. Take that thumb, boom, put it right down, push the tongue down, stealth-like. And so I want it to be so automatic for you, nip, boom. Your thumb goes right in like that, and then you give your dog your hand like this, and they'll lick your hand. So you got it? So also, be careful what you're doing. You might be encouraging your dog to bite. It happens all the time. But yes, puppies bite. You're the one with a 12-week-old dog. So don't be surprised. It's all part of the process. That's like saying you've got a 2-year-old kid and it shits and pisses in its diaper. That's just what it does. You can't be surprised. But what we want to do is we want to get that dog, just like we want to get the kid potty trained as quick as possible, we want to get that dog out of its nipping stage. Also, I don't want to get that dog nipping me or my kids. The number one age for a dog being turned into a shelter is 1 year old. Most dogs are turned into shelters below 1 year old. Every single one of those people say, I would never give up my dog. Guess what? Millions of people do. 5 million dogs are killed in shelters. So I assure you, you will, and you are a candidate for giving up your dog. Just the way it is. All right? The way it is. Jeff Gellman of Solid Canine Training. I'm actually a real dog trainer, and I actually travel the world training dogs doing seminars.
Counter conditioning protocols for human aggressive dog or dog aggressive dog?
Okay. two different major things, and Periscope is not the platform for that. It is a very intense multi-step process. But the first thing we do is we have to correct the biting. We stop the biting. So most people see step two in my videos. We use food conditioning, clicker conditioning, we use markers all the time. But you don't see step one. Step one is a high consequence for biting. Remember, I train dog killers, I rehabilitate dog killers. I also rehabilitate dogs who try to physically harm humans, not always out of fear, out of predatory aggression as well. All right, predatory aggression. Throwing food on the ground, that's step two. You missed step one. We don't show step one. Why? Nobody needs to see step one. Step one is we make the dog's life suck for 3 seconds. So throwing food on the ground is called, it's food grazing. It's a little bit different. It's a very structured environment with dog stuff. But rehabilitating dog aggressive dogs, it's muzzle work. It's all muzzle work. Your dog wants to be, make sure your dog is muzzle conditioned. Either way, you need a great baseline platform of dog obedience. So no matter what you do, you need your dog to know baseline. Sorry, I've got an itch of my nose. You need your dog to know baseline obedience no matter what. So you might as well do that now. You might as well teach your dog place, down, sit, recall, walk on a leash, don't jump on doors, shut up when I tell you to shut up, no free roaming, kenneling up at night, kenneling up when I'm not home. So you might as well do all that stuff anyway. All right? You might as well do that, all that stuff anyway. Then what you're going to be doing is you're going to be stopping the aggression, and then you're going to be counter conditioning. Don't use a prong to stop barking at a door. Use a bonker or a remote collar. A bonker or a remote collar. So a bonker is a wrapped up towel. You have a towel? Grab that towel really quick, Linda, right by the bananas. Thank you. A wrapped up towel. Oh, it is a wrapped up towel. You wrap it up and then you put some elastics on it. So here's a cotton towel.
You're going to have bonkers ready for
this. I know. A cotton towel, you'd roll it up like this, roll it up like this. You'd put an elastic around it. You would take it. You would say N-O. You always say no first. That's your marker. You whip it at the dog's head. Boom. You whip it at the dog's head. You're not going to hit the dog. It is a cotton towel. It's a cotton towel. Okay, you do that, and then you can always recall it to you, or you can use a remote collar and tell it to shut up. All right, when the dog is prong collar, that means you got to walk over to the dog. I don't want to walk over to the dog. I want the dog to shut up on its own. So what do? You have to interrupt slash correct it slash punish it. I'm a balanced dog trainer. We do a ton of positive and a ton of punishment. We don't get into science here. Why? 99.9% of the people out there aren't even capable of speaking the science properly. But if you want to get into it, there is four quadrants. Two of them are actually punishments. So that's what you've got to do first. Then you get to train the dog on what you want it to do. So you have to stop the bad behavior and then train it what you want it to do. That's how you stop dog at door barking. Jeff Gellman, Solid Canine Training. If you like what you hear, cool. Little character in the corner. Share this on Facebook. Share this on Twitter. Share this on Periscope. If you don't like what you hear, statistically, you're going to stay on twice as long as the people that actually like it, right?
We use the pet convincer and tell her no and shut up all the time, but as soon as I leave, she starts.
I know. That's why you should be using a remote collar. Next.
How about a German Shepherd puppy, 3 months, has anxiety, bad all night?
Okay, so with your anxiety dog, separation anxiety dog, that's 12 weeks old. It's very, very common to do that. So they recently left the litter. They probably were used to hanging out with other dogs. What I want you to do is massive amounts of structure. Also, what I want you to do is shut the dog up in the crate. A 12-week-old dog should be spending 18 to 20 hours in the crate. The only time the dog should be out of the crate is this. Potty time, structured, one place at the exact same time, every single time, on a leash. The dog should have a leash on in the house, no free roaming at all. The dog only needs to see one room in your house. Then what I want you to do is I want you to do obedience commands. Obedience commands are done with food. You should be doing all food protocols. Recall, sit, down, place, all right, with your food. Dog should learn how to kennel up. Dog should learn how to come out of the kennel. Dog should also learn how now to shut up in the kennel. You can actually shut up a dog in a kennel at 12 weeks old by using a correction. It will not ruin the relationship with the dog. You know how you ruin the relationship with the dog? You turn it into a shelter. Guess what? Your relationship sucks. So that's what you do. So you correct it. Next question.
Next one topic Periscope on teach a dog how to have an on-off switch.
Sure, write that down. Make up one topic Periscope, Finns. One topic Periscope.
This paper's not good.
All right, okay, introduce yourself.
At what age can you start using a bark collar?
You can start using a bark collar at 14 weeks old. 14 weeks old, hold on one second here. I'm gonna actually start do it this way. Let's see, blog ideas, book ideas, vision boards, morning motivation ideas, cheat sheet notes, much to Periscope ideas. Bingo, Periscope ideas. Okay, and there you go. How to train your dog to have an on-off switch. Bingo. Okay, next question.
On a walk, if my dog sees another dog, he will lay down until they pass.
Okay, so what I want you to do is this. Okay, who's running the show here? You or the dog? Right now, the dog is running the show. So it's actually too bright, Linda. It's actually too bright.
Yeah, I'm kidding.
So turn off one of the lights, please. It's too bright, all right? So what I want you to do is this. Proper training tool. We like prong collars. Why? Because they're effective training tool. And let me just go up. Other way. Nope. Ooh, that's much better. That's much better. Yep. And when we go back to Providence, we're actually going to get professional lighting installed. We're actually turning one of our bedrooms into a Periscope studio, a social media studio. Yep. All right. So what I want you to do is this. Prong collar on, teach the dog how to walk next to you. Whether you pull or you lag behind, we don't do that. If you allow that dog to put the brakes on, if you allow that dog to stop and put the brakes on, and what will happen is that dog goes, I can get away with whatever I want to do. So the dog probably wants to engage or play or check it out. So, or it could be afraid. All right, next.
My puppy is also very attached to me. She whines every time I'm away from her. It's just with me.
Okay, so what I want you to do is you're probably giving your dog too much love and affection. You possibly are picking up your dog. You possibly are cuddling your dog too much. What I want you to do is I want you to start doing this, creating space. The way you create space is with a place command. The way you create space is by creating your dog. Teach your dog to be independent. If you don't teach your dog to be independent, you are going to have a whiny, clingy dog. Whiny, clingy dog, which will drive you nuts. You'll be shitting on the toilet and the dog will be standing there watching you. Okay? Don't do it, please. Don't do it. It's up to you to start creating space from your dog. It's up to you. How do you do that? Teach it a command such as place, where the dog actually has to stay a little bit away from you. All right? If you have to use a tie-out station, use a tie-out station. So you want to do all of those things, because maybe at one point it was cute, but I assure you it will become annoying really quick. And guess what? It sounds, from the sounds of it, it already is annoying. My name is Jeff Gellman of Solid Canine Training. If you're just tuning in, welcome. I do this every Monday and Wednesday night, 9 p.m. till 10:05 Eastern Standard Time. It's my 402nd Periscope. I do 2 to 3 Periscopes a day, though. Don't forget that. Next.
Why does my 2-year-old pit bull lick me excessively when I let her on the bed only once a month?
Okay. Number one, I would check your sodium levels, number one. All right, I would check your sodium levels. I would also get blood work done to the dog, but also because you're allowing your dog to do it. Okay, you're allowing your dog to do it. So what I would do is, the dog licks you because you either taste good or taste bad. Why? Dogs lick ice cream and they also lick shit. So, what are you gonna do? So I would correct it. Pet convincer you can use to correct it. Yeah, but I would check your sodium levels, but also check the dog's. Check the dogs. All right.
14-week-old dog really starting to blow off basic commands, waiting on delivery of e-collar.
I wouldn't rush to the e-collar. Okay, so let me just explain something here. So your 14-week-old dog, it is possible that you have not done enough foundation work. Also, it's a 14-week-old dog. You're not going to be getting a ton of duration out of a 14-week-old dog. And a 14-week-old dog, they're just learning what the letters are. They barely know what the words are. They don't know what the sentences are, and they sure as heck don't know what the paragraphs are. All right? So, and their punctuation sucks. So be super, super careful about getting frustrated with a 14-week-old dog not holding commands. What I would do is I would just be really patient, take your time, keep your training sessions to 5 minutes, do frequent training sessions, all right? Take a step back. Because the last thing I want you to do, at 14 weeks old, we don't correct dogs with remote collars, and I don't want you doing that either. That's going to mess up the dog at 14 weeks old. The last thing I want you to do is if that dog blows off a command, for you to give that dog a correction at 14 weeks old. That's not what we teach. So I'm encouraging you not to do that. Right? Be patient. Just be patient. Right? Next.
How long throughout the day should I let my dog be in place and in a crate during the day while home?
So what you can do is you can break it up. I want your dog, split it up 50-50. How's that? While you're home, 50-50. So while you're home, you can do crate time, place time, active training, duration work, and play, and potty time. Don't forget about the potty time. All right?
Have new Great Pyrenees, 5 years old. How to get dog to sit? Very stubborn but calm.
All right. So very. You got a five-year-old dog with stubborn. Stubborn means lack of communication. You've got to figure out what the dog's motivation is. Remember, this is dog training to me. I'm going to simplify it. Okay, ready? Yes, no. Do this, don't do that. Now we have to talk about motivation. All right? Now we have to talk about motivation. How do I get you to do this? How do I get you to do that? All right? That's what we want to do. So what's the motive? Now we have to come up with motivation for the dog. So I would use food. I would use food and a remote collar. Layer it. Food and remote collar. Got it? Food and remote collar. Jeff Gellman of Sound Canine Training. If you're just tuning in, welcome. Welcome to my show. There's a little character in the corner. Click on the little character on the corner. Share this on Facebook. Share this on Twitter. It's time for a share break, guys. Let's go. Share. Everybody share this, and then we'll continue the show. I need hearts, and I need shares. If you want to do a screenshot, do a screenshot. All right? So click on the little corner. Share this on Facebook. Share this on Twitter. Share this on Periscope. Also, sign up for my Periscope. Become one of my followers. LM Cap, Street Glider, nice. Very nice. All right. Asterix Cafe, shared it on Twitter. I've invited followers, begging for balance, share this on Twitter. Mama Hans, invited followers. Thank you so much. Results K9. That's a good name, Results K9. All right. Meitner Cascone, very good. Snee J. Okay. Vic Wilder. Okay, great. Now we'll keep answering questions. Okay, great.
When do you use continuous stim on e-collar versus just a tap on it?
Okay, everybody has a different way they want to train on a recall, train on remote collar. We do pressure on, pressure off with a remote collar. So that would be up to you to decide how your remote collar training protocol is going to work, how it's going to work. It's sort of like some people are teaching, you know, what's that new math? Is it new math?
Yeah, Common Core.
Yeah, some people are teaching Common Core, which is wrong, and then other people are teaching the right way to train, the right way to teach. So it all depends on how you want to teach your dog to do it. Both of them can work very effectively. We personally do continuous on, continuous off, because we pair that also with leash pressure. We pair that with leash pressure. All right, next question.
How to get a 12-week-old German Shepherd to stop barking, whining in the crate?
How old's the dog?
12 weeks.
12 weeks old. 12 weeks old. You're gonna be putting that up. Thanks, Dr. Cool. You're gonna be put up with a little bit of nonsense. You can walk up to the crate, bang the crate, tell the dog to shut up. Just try that. All right.
Dog comes when called, but sometimes walks very slow. Is this a problem to be concerned with?
What I would do is I would use a leash. If you want to use a leash, gentle pops, get that dog motivated, or use food. The only way that dog is going to eat. Is through recall training. How's that? That dog wants to eat? Oh, it better get to you quick. Quicker it gets to you, the quicker it gets food. There was another question that we missed.
I have a bunch.
Okay, go ahead.
Need help with dog anxiety. Loses mind when boyfriend or I exit car or home.
Okay, so what I want you to do is teach that dog calming stuff. So calming stuff is duration work. Placing down, placing down, placing down. What I find historically that everybody gets their dog in high drive all the time. They keep the dog in high drive, and they never allow that dog to actually relax. They never actually, you know, let that dog relax. So what I want you to do is when you're not in the car, what I want you to do is teach that dog how to be calm at home. How do you do that? Duration work. Duration place, duration down, lots of structure in your dog's life. Don't let that dog free roam. Don't let that dog just get randomly excited. Don't let the dog control the plane. I don't want your dog to control the plane. You control the plane, okay? If the dog goes nuts in the car, remote collar, don't go nuts in the car. Teach your dog yes and no. It's so important that people teach their dogs yes and no. That's really, really important, okay?
I have a similar question.
Yes.
How do you calm a dog who is very reactive in a car when driving by anything moving?
That would be a remote collar, right? Remote collar. I've never replaced a battery on an eCower Technologies remote. I don't know, but I bet you there's a video on it on the eCower.com, or you can go to YouTube and YouTube it. It probably is not that difficult. I imagine you probably need a Phillips head screwdriver. Also, please wear glasses in case it explodes. Not because of eCower Technologies, because it's a battery and batteries explode. You can't find it, I would give Greg a call. Results can. I give Greg a call. Give Greg a call. I know there's a rubber seal because it's waterproof. Most likely there's a rubber seal. It's probably not that difficult. It can't be. It can't be that difficult. It just can't be. You know why? I think they assemble them there because they import the parts and they assemble them. So the batteries might even be domestic. I don't know. All right, next.
Do you have any breed-specific instructions when training different breeds?
No, I do not. Smaller dogs are just lower to the ground. So this is it. I'm a family dog trainer, so I don't do sport. So I'm a family dog trainer. So I train and reinforce what I want out of the dog, and I eliminate what I don't want out of the dog. So being a family dog trainer, most people are struggling with the same things. So I don't have any breed-specific stuff. So I don't, other than Basenjis don't need bark collars. Other than that, not much, not much. And Huskies can be off-leash trained, by the way. Always remember that. Next.
Should the very first command to master on e-collar be recall?
No, I would actually train place. I would do place. I would do place and sit on remote collar first. Place and sit on remote collar first, and then do recall. That's what I would do. That is what we do usually. That's what I would do. Next.
How do I handle charging off-leash dogs?
Ooh, that should be a good, that's going to be a, oh my God, that's a one subject one. Hold on 1 second. How do I handle charging off-leash dogs? That's going to be a one subject Periscope. So, I have something called neutralizing the threat. Neutralizing the threat. I'm a huge advocate of neutralizing off-leash dogs. Some people are going to struggle with this conversation. If you struggle with this conversation, no disrespect to you, and I apologize. But if you've ever seen your dogs attacked, if you've ever seen an off-leash dog kill another dog, and if you've ever seen an off-leash dog put somebody in the hospital, and I have seen all three, you'll understand my passion behind what I'm about to say. You do everything possible to make sure you neutralize that dog from getting into your bubble. So, how do we start? Your dog's on a leash, take your dogs, put your dogs behind you, stand in front of your dogs, no. Verbal, no. Move towards your dog, nice and big. Before you do that, you can look on the ground, pick up sand, rocks, pebbles, dirt, anything. Get ready to throw that in the dog's face. You can have a bear spray on you or mace sprayed in the dog's face. Be very concerned or aware of which way the wind is blowing. Okay, directly in the dog's face. The first thing you should also be ready to do is use your feet, not your hands. Use your feet, not your hands. Pet convincer could also work. The problem with the pet convincer is it might not work. Also, the dogs that you're with might be freaked out by a pet convincer. If everybody doesn't know what a pet convincer is, it's just a blast of air. It's the same thing as a bicycle tire pump, which has been retrofitted, right? It might not always work, but yes, I've seen it work. Okay, but if you're going to do it, you use your feet. Always use your feet to kick the dog. Where do you kick? You kick the dog below the rib cage. You kick the dog in the face. Okay, okay, hard. Commit. You have to be ready to physically harm that dog. I'm not saying you should be out kicking dogs. It's called self-preservation. I have no problem at all. My dogs have been attacked. I've had my dogs hospitalized. I've had colleagues' dogs killed. Their dogs have been killed on a walk Could you imagine you wake up at 8:30 in the morning, you drink your cup of coffee, you're out for a nice walk with your dog, and you come back with no dog because it's dead. Bottom line is you neutralize the off-leash dog. I don't care if it's friendly or not. You don't know it. Stun baton works as well. Thank you, Brandy. A stun baton, what you do is you go on to Amazon, look up stun baton. They've got them from $27 to $55. You can carry those as well. Okay? So that's what you do. I take it very, very seriously. The last thing I want is one of my dogs being killed because I was afraid I might hurt the other dog. I have no problem at all. No problem at all. All right?
I thought of throwing a bag of poo at off-leash dogs. Think that would work?
No. Next.
Is place anywhere in a down position?
No, it's not, actually. Actually, it's not. Down is anywhere in a down position. That's a really great question, by the way. So down is, by the way, after that little diatribe, hello, my name is Jeff Gellman of Solid Canine Training. Website, solidcaninetraining.com, little character on the corner. Click on that little character on the corner. Share this on Facebook. Share this on Twitter. Share this on Periscope. I wouldn't throw food at the dog. Do you know why? You're training the dog to chase people. You're training the dog to chase people. The dog goes, oh, maybe it'll help you, but the next person will end up getting attacked. So I'd rather make a very strong impression on the dog, not to rush people. So anyway, what was the question?
I don't know. Hold on.
All right, next question.
No.
Okay.
Is place anywhere in a down
position? Oh, place. No, so down is anywhere in a down position. Down is anywhere in a down position. Place is always on an object, like a dog bed, a dog mat, a blanket. It could be a t-shirt. It could be a carpet square. That's place. Place has to be an object they go to. It could be a raised platform. We prefer dogs down in place, but place is always a physical thing, right? Physical thing, all right?
When you teach puppies e-collar, how do you extend the teaching phase? How long?
We do teaching until the dog gets it. So we do the learning stage, we do till the dog gets it, and then we do, and then we work up to duration, and then we proof it, and then we go to distraction, and then we go to correction. All right? So we do that. And we're patient. We do it all on a leash. So all of our remote work we usually do on leash. Leash and then remote. Because remember, the remote isn't doing the training. The training's doing the training. The remote is just, what the remote is doing is, the remote is just communicating the training to the dog. So I always tell people, if you would just put a remote up to somebody, to a dog, and push a button, the dog's not going to listen to you. They don't understand what it means. They don't understand what it means. All right.
At what age can you start a dog e-collar training?
That was already asked, but we'll answer it again. That's an easy one. That's 14. We start at 14 weeks old, and it's used for informational purposes only, and it's done with food.
Dog wants to walk ahead during heel.
Okay. Yeah, so if your dog is pulling, I've got a bunch of videos on pulling. It's probably the number one problem that I get. Leash pulling, leash reactivity. So what I would do is make sure you're using the proper equipment. So the proper equipment, and what we do is we love training equipment. We like to empower our clients with training equipment. So what we do is we would use a prong collar, remote collar, and you can, I've got videos on that. And what we would do is you can do a bunch of 180s. You can do remote collar heeling with your dog. You can do a remote collar heeling with your dog. And what I would do is watch some of my videos on how to properly heel a dog. It's better to see the visual on that. But what you're probably doing is, it's possibly the dog is getting too far ahead of you. Then you're giving that dog information. Instead, what I want you to do is I want you to give that dog information prior to it getting ahead of you. Once it gets ahead of you, you've got to you're using more force than you actually need. But when it's almost getting ahead of you or thinking about getting ahead of you, that's when you would give it that information with the remote or the prong. All right? Next question.
At what week should you stop puppies from playing hard with each other?
I have no problem with puppies playing hard with each other forever, as long as they can stop on command. Does that make sense? So play fighting does not lead to real fighting. Most dogs that fight are under-socialized, not overly socialized. They're under-socialized. Keep that in mind. So play fighting is healthy if you can stop it. If you're going to allow a dog to get all excited, you better be able to get a dog to stop. And you better be able to get a dog to stop immediately. All right? So you can do it forever. I've got dogs that play rough every single day. But when I go, enough? Sorry, girl. They all stop. And I've got videos of that, actually. I've got videos in my personal property. I've got six dogs that usually hang out together, and they all play, and I can just tell them enough and or down them all. We do that all the time. All right, next question.
Should I always insist on down when dog is in place?
We do. Unless you're doing drills, like if you watch one of my Periscopes from yesterday where I did, I was having fun. Let's see, there was a Periscope yesterday with Angelo and girl, a swimming pool, a ball in place. All right. And what I do is I threw her up on plate, threw her. She went to place, she sat, and then I threw the ball in the pool. If you saw that. So I always don't, but for duration work, absolutely. Like right now, three of our dogs are in place and a down over yonder. And Angelo was in place right there behind us. So I do. All depends what you're doing. All right, next.
What e-collar do you recommend for a 14-week GSD?
Awesome, 911 K9. Cool. Be careful on that ambulance. All right. What I would do is I would get the e-collar technologies 300. And you have the E300, and we sell them on our website, or you can buy them on Amazon or get them direct from e-collar technologies. But it'd be nice if you bought them from us. We do 20 hours of free content on Periscope, 1,000 videos, 50,000 hours of free content on Facebook. It'd be good if people bought some product from us, but you don't have to. I really don't care. I really don't care where you get the product from. If you can find a better price somewhere else. Yep. Oh, thank you. Thank you, Kyle. You're welcome, Tyler. Tyler, you're brand new to me too, Tyler. Unless you've been like sitting in the background. Are you brand new, Tyler? You don't look familiar. What's a couple of weeks? Cool. Thank you. Thanks for sticking around. I'm glad I haven't pissed you off. Great Pyrenees. I would actually go with the Great Pyrenees. I would go to the 800 probably. I'd go to the 800 and I would get thick fur contact points and I'd go to the 800 just in case you need it. Great. Make sure you, with that Great Pyrenees, thank you, Tyler. That's a working dog. Okay. That's a working dog. Great Pyrenees. I've worked with some really nasty ones. Like, I want to bite you and I won't stop till I do. So let's make sure we've got lots of structure with those dogs. All right, what else do we got?
Can I use a prong collar with an e-collar or invisible fence collar?
Yes, you can. Yep. Is 300 okay for a husky? It is. You might need an 800 though. All depends on how sensitive the husky is. And again, on a husky, use the thick fur contact points. All depends. We use the 300 on over 90% of our dogs. It's not necessarily the breed, but sometimes you just get a lot of hard-headed dogs. And sometimes you just need a little bit more. When I release my dog out of the crate, she books it to her bed. Would you recommend me training her to come out of the crate? And say, I would. Yeah, why not? Or call her over to you to a down. Do that. Call her over to you to a down. Yep. Have her down in front of the crate. Have her sit in front of the crate. Have her go back into the crate. Have her come back out of the crate. You know, so Kelly, mix it up a little bit. Mix it up. You can't train too much. Yeah, the 400 is good. 400 is good. 400 is more stronger than the 300. But I'm, you know, again, it's so hard to tell with breeds sometimes because we've used the 300 on so many dogs. We've had to use the 800 on like, I don't know, some of these just mutt dogs. You never know. You never know. Like my one of my German Shepherds girl, her correction level was a 3. She's like a really sensitive dog.
Confused every time I get near place, he runs to it.
And you don't want him to? So what you would have to do is, Gabe, yes, I recommend remote collars for every single dog. He runs to it. Okay, so what I want you to do is this. Okay, teach the dog. That's pretty cool though, right? That he runs to place. I mean, that's not the worst thing in the world. What could be worse is every time he got towards place, he ran out the front door, right? So what I would do is I would do downs next to place, right? I would call him off place into a down. I would do recall to down, go from down to place. But it's not the worst. That's not the worst thing at all. I mean, anytime you get your dog to do like that by default, that's pretty effing cool. If you're just tuning in, my name is Jeff Gellman of Solid Canine Training. Hey, let's do a screenshot. Come here, Linda. So this is the way a screenshot works. If what you're gonna do is everybody's gonna do a screenshot. And the way you do a screenshot is you hit your like your on-off button and your function button, at least on an iOS phone, and then you're gonna tweet the photo to me. What you do is you go to Twitter and you put in at Solid Canine Training, because that's my handle on Twitter. That's how you would send out a tweet, at Solid Canine Training. You attach media, attach a photo. You're going to attach that photo of Linda and I, and then you're gonna put
Linda and me,
and then you're gonna put in it, I love Linda and I, okay?
Don't say that, guys.
Okay, ready? Screenshot, 12 seconds. Okay, great. Okay, enough of that nonsense. All right. So, next question. Wait, you're a new follower thinking about coming to the seminar in April with a friend? You're thinking about coming to T3, the T3 seminar? Ooh, that would be good. That would be really, really good. Yeah, you'll learn a ton of stuff. Jeff, my dogs are fully trained indoors. Different story outside. Yes, they do. So just keep in mind. Oh, good for you. That'd be great. Yeah. Ooh, that's almost sold out, by the way. You should talk. Make sure you get a hold of Laura Morgan on that. That's a life-changing seminar. So you're thinking, are you a dog trainer or thinking about becoming a dog trainer? That seminar will rock your world. That's going to really rock your world. That will like change your life. That's a 7-day seminar that will change your life. Yeah, Ruger Pup, awesome. T3 remote, there's nothing planned for T3 remote. I think it's on the website, but there's nothing planned. All right, B. Miller, 5. You should really think about it. It is an investment. It's a very good investment. Anyway, so just remember, okay, you're the friend. Oh, learning balance. Awesome. Congratulations. First of all, I want to congratulate you. Second of all, I'm not like this at T3, just to give you a heads up. All right. T3 is a very, very business-like, much calmer atmosphere. My Monday and Wednesday Q&As, I would say, are half entertainment, half information. The information, though, is correct and true. But this is more of the, like, you know, this is just more of like out of control, Jeff. So just to clarify that. And also, when I train dogs, I actually don't talk. If you ever see me train a dog, I'm silent. Okay. Anyway, so dog listens to you inside, doesn't listen to you outside. Absolutely. It's called distractions. So you've got distractions. And then what happens is, what do you have to do? Go back to kindergarten. All right. So it's like leash back on, start at your basics, be patient, don't get frustrated, work on focus, all right? Work on focused, okay?
Just took dog talking about the Great Pyrenees. Yes. Not familiar with Great Pyrenees. Do I need to be afraid of it?
Is it aggressive? You tell me. Now, I'm just telling you, I've worked with some really, we have to remember, our specialty is aggression rehab. So our specialty is aggression rehab. So then don't worry about it. Don't worry about it. Have fun with it. Have fun with it. Have fun with it. Yep. Have fun with it.
Are you ready for the next
one? Yes.
Do you have a Periscope or video on proper way to intro and use tug play as a reward?
No, I don't. But I don't teach tug, but I can show you how I do it. All right. Do Periscope on how to play tug with your dog. No, I don't. I don't have it.
Do you have any seminars planned in Chicago?
Yes, I do. In August. The date is not released and the location is not released because the contract is not signed. But it's going to be in August and it's going to be 30 minutes or 25 minutes outside of Chicago. This August. Yes, this August. Yes.
Thanks, Mama Hans.
Am I coming for sure? Oh, you're coming for sure. Good. Yeah. Until the contract is signed, nothing is for sure. The next event in Texas, it's already on the website. It is in November. I want to do Austin first or Dallas first?
Austin's first.
We're doing Austin first. The week before Thanksgiving, we do Austin. If you go to rvdogtrainer.com, rvdogtrainer.com, you'll see my schedule, and we add dates to it. If anybody's in Australia, I will be in Australia for 2 weeks. We're doing Lexington. Yeah, we do Lexington. Yeah, our Austin seminar is Lexington. And then we do Dallas. I do Dallas as well. Yeah, we actually don't do it in Austin. We do it in Lexington because I love Red Mark Kennels. I love Red Mark Kennels. RV Dog Training coming back to Baltimore? I might. Nothing's in the works. I would love to do a seminar in Ohio. I would love to do a seminar in Ohio. I need a place to do it and a sponsor. So if you know of a dog training facility who's done seminars before that wants to be my host, boom, it's done. It's done. We'll do it. T3 Accelerate, we might only be doing it once a year. It might be turned into an online class. We don't know. How many days do we need? It's a two-day seminar. It's Saturday and Sundays. You go to Chicago. Good. Chicago's close to Ohio. It's close. People drive 18 hours to go to my seminars for the weekend. Make 8 months sit, lay, and wait for okay before food. Start whining and not laying. Finally, fake lay. Hey, I don't know about you, but I'm not in for fake lays. If I'm going to get laid, I want it for real. So I would go with a real one. I would be like, your dog, your Corey, bam, right? Fist bump, buddy. So your dog is pulling your chain. It's pulling your chain. Just stand there. Just stand there and wait your dog out if you want to. I'm originally from Ohio. I'm from the east side of Cleveland, Lyndhurst, Ohio. Class of 1984, I went to Brush High School. Bam. Went to Brush High School. I was a really, really. Lime green Ford Econoline van. That's where the party was. That's where the party was. Yeah. Yeah, it was a lot of fun. A lot of fun. I grew up in the 80s. What do we got next?
Is it okay to have crate available anytime dog wants or only let in or let out by me?
That's an excellent question. So to me, all depends on your dog. I prefer to only let the dog in the crate when I say so. All right? Yeah, Linda gets repulsed when I talk about a lot of things. But she was a pretty bad kid too.
I was not.
How much time did you spend in the principal's office?
Not very much.
Linda Gellman, you went to an all-girl Catholic school. How much time did you spend in the principal's office?
A couple hours.
A day.
A year.
No. You can't even look at the screen.
A couple hours. Total. me. Who sent Mama Hans? Are you agreeing with him?
Yeah, Mama Hans knows. Mom, you know. Mama,
we're not friends anymore, Mama Hans. That's it. I'm done.
She knows. I used to get paddled. Who went to school?
You did not.
Yes, I did. Who went to school that had they had a yellow line on the floor? It was in our boiler room. So in the boiler room of the school, there was a yellow line on the thing, and the assistant principal would come in with a wooden paddle. We had to bend over, and we got swatted.
Lies.
No. Anybody else? Am I the only one? No. Sorry, that was very prevalent back then. Yes.
What, Catholic schoolgirls are not wild.
You got hit at home? Yep. They had it at your school, yep. Our school too. Thank you.
When did you go to school? The Middle Ages?
No. Yep, they have paddle. A ton of people do. They put you in the basement. Yep, I got swatted. All these people did. It was very common. Thank you.
That's awful.
Thank you. All right, next question. Yeah, Corey Michael. Corey, that's right.
Corey, I'm done with Corey too. Okay. I don't have any more questions right now.
Come on.
Corey, you're dead to me.
Come on, what else? What else do we got? Linda, any questions?
No.
Okay. Let's get some questions. Jeff Gellman of Solid Canine Training. Little character in the corner. Click on the little character. Don't forget on the replays. On the replays, you can actually swipe and share. And on the replays, you can give hearts. So a lot of people don't even know you can give hearts on the replays. How do you give hearts? By tapping your screen. And on the replays, you can swipe and share. On an iOS, you go this way, and bam. And Android, you go up and down.
You know what? There's no more fist pumps on this.
Why not?
No more.
We bump. We fist pump.
No. I'm putting down my foot.
Okay.
I'm curious, how do you deal with dogs that are afraid of you and not aggressive, but avoidant?
Yeah, so what I would do with that, that's a really great question. So you have to actually build a relationship. So the way you build a relationship, the best way to really build a relationship is through food. Hey, Gabe, boom. So what I would do, stop.
I was told to do that.
I know, but Terry, don't encourage her. So what I would do is this. Leash on the dog and food. Training is a great way to build a relationship as well. Training is, just remember, at the beginning, you don't need a dog to like you. Actually, forever you don't need a dog to like you, all right? You just need a dog to listen to you. So your role, my role, John's role and the training team's role in the board and train is to get the dogs to listen to us. Yes, it would be nice if you can build a relationship. Yes, relationships are very important. But when you're with a dog for 2 or 3 weeks, DNA tests are a waste of money, all right? What you would do is I would use a food-based training program or toy for reward. Find out what the dog motivates the dog. So what motivates that dog? Food, praise, toys. Great. The dog gets none of those things until they start doing what you want to do. Right? Want to do. How to tell the difference between aggressive playing or just being aggressive? Blood. And emergency room visits. All right? What you do, see Angelo, it's my assistant, Lauren, Lauren, Lauren at Solid Canine Training. What you do is this, go to my website, rvdogtrainer.com. Somebody wants to pop it up there for me. And there's an application to host. All right? And then Lauren will call you back. And she knows all the different specifications we need. We're going to want to see photos. We might want to see video. We Google map it to see what it looks like from the sky. And then we go to the person's website to see how they're doing with social and if they've hosted seminars before. There's a lot of dog trainers in Ohio, though, because there's a dog training school in Ohio. So there's a ton of dog trainers. All right?
How about getting your dog to sit from a distance? Always seems to come to me, then sit or down.
Kyle, use a tie-out station. Do a tie-out station. So what I want you to do with a tie-out station is you got the leash on the dog, you would tie it to something, and then you would move away. Start out by doing it from 1 foot away, 2 foot away, 3 foot away, 4 feet away. I would also use a clicker. Do clicker, and food and a tie-out station. That's how I would do it. That is how we do it. All right?
Dog distracted during structured walk, how to get the dog to focus on the walk no matter what.
Okay. So what I would do on all, what I want people to do, you're welcome, Kyle. What I want people to do is I want people to do remote cower training. I want people to do remote cower training. Remote cower healing is great because what it can do is it can keep the dog from getting ahead of you. But also if the dog is looking away from you, you can give the dog a little bit of a tap tap and the dog goes like that. So what you do is you train the dog with remote cower training for focus work, and then you bring it onto the walk.
Sorry if already covered, but I have a 3-dog pack, 1 older female, 2 males. Do I have to worry about?
Allow an alpha. So this is the thing. I've got 9 dogs, and we have a very good pack dynamic. The only time I've ever had a problem is I brought a new dog home. I am bringing a new dog home from Holland. I imported a dog, and Kira comes home the middle of March. So she'll be interesting to see how she does with the pack. We had one problem for about 30 seconds with a dog named Jackie, who we brought in to the pack probably about, 8 months ago, a 7-year-old male German Shepherd. And there was one moment in the swimming pool where him and Mac, one of my, a dog that actually works outside of my property and patrols my property, he tried to get a little bit too dominant with Mac. And instead of Max told him not to, but he wouldn't stop. So then I literally jumped into the swimming pool and I took care of it myself. Other than that, we have never had a problem at all. So I think that I'm not a big advocate of dogs working things out. I'm a big advocate of us. Yeah, Jackie, Peter, he tried some stupid nonsense with Mac. You know, he is a punk. I'm not a big advocate of dogs figuring things out on their own. I'm a big advocate of us giving them leadership and guidance. So, you know, until you know, you don't know. The best thing you can do though is put structure in their lives, give them lots of guidance, shut down any nonsense whatsoever. Jackie absolutely got a correction. Of course, by me. Yep, he had to. Of course, that's the only way you stop that stuff is by giving a dog a correction.
How do you decide which dogs become part of your pack?
Well, it depends what I'm, so I was looking for dogs. So I always need dogs because I need dogs to work. So I need dogs to be working. I need dogs to work at the training center. I like having lots of dogs. So it all depends. I get offered dogs constantly, but most dogs are not qualified because I'm not looking for an aggressive dog to rehab to join my pack. I'm not looking for that. I do that all, you know, we do that all day long. I'm looking for balanced dogs. I don't care if they're not trained or not, but I'm not looking to have like, you know, a dog killer be part of my pack. Most of my dogs that are with me now, some of them have had aggression issues, but now for me to bring a new dog in, I'm not interested in that. I'm past all that stuff. I'm not interested in that. We rehabilitate aggressive dogs as part of my business, but for my personal pack, I'm not interested in bringing in an aggressive dog, rehabbing it, and then keeping it in my pack. I'm just not. So I was offered a client's dog that I worked with 5 years prior, and I said, yep, I can use another dog. A year ago, I had one dog die. And then while we were on this road trip, I actually had my other oldest dog die, Uma. She was my best working dog. She died on this trip. She was 12 years old, had some complications for surgery, and she ended up dying out in San Diego as part of this trip. But I knew she was getting old and I was going to be retiring her anyway. So I've been looking for dogs. So I said, let's try the dog out. And I tried the dog out. And the number one thing it had to do was be safe around my children. Number one is my children. So I had to be safe around my kids. So after I had the dog for a couple of days, I just put Angelo out in the play yard with the dog. And I'm like, hey, Ann, just go, let's go outside and see what's up with Jackie. And that worked out fine. And I had no problems with Jackie and the kids. So then Jackie got along with the dogs, and then I decided to keep him. So I sort of did a weekend, you know, visitation to see how it go, what you see how it went, and it went fine. So we kept him. I've got a new dog coming in from Holland, and it's a special dog. He was purchased specifically from a police canine breeder. He's in Ohio right now. He is two. She just turned two. I get her on March 8th, and she's been trained specifically for bite work, tracking, apprehension, and explosive detection. And then I've got a local place up in Massachusetts that I will be taking her to twice a week to continue with further education. So I keep getting more and more knowledgeable. It's sort of going to be like a hobby that might be a paid hobby at some point for me. Yep. So that's sort of like, I'm interested in that now. So I'm not going to do IPO or Schutzend or anything like that. I'm not interested in competition. To me, life is a competition. I'd rather do that. I'm also don't want to deal with all the politics and the bullshit of stuff like that. We don't do CGC testing at all. I'm not against CGC testing, but a lot of aggressive dogs that I've rehabbed have their CGCs. So I think CGC is a great, thing, but it gives owners a false sense. A false sense of security that they actually have a really good dog. So we have to be super, super careful about that. But I don't have a problem with the CGC. What?
We have these questions to get through, and there's more. So
okay, great.
My dog will follow me from room to room and then hold up down position there.
Okay, so that's not the worst thing in the world, but I would start getting the dog to do place in other rooms. Next question.
Is it okay for head to be slightly ahead of you or keep the nose at the leg when healing?
My personal preference is I want the dog's nose to be a little bit behind my leg. My personal preference. But you're not that far off. All right?
Dog used to rush door barking, now holds down, but sometimes barks from there.
Okay. Use a remote collar. Tell the dog to shut up.
Do you know of a therapy dog organization for my uncle? He is a Vietnam vet who has PTSD.
I do not. And I would be really careful. There's a lot of scams going on out there, a lot of fly-by-night companies out there, a lot of dogs being sold that couldn't even hold a downstay, let alone becoming a therapy dog, and they're being sold for $10,000. Be super careful. Next.
What is the best waste management system for a multi-dog household?
The City of Providence on Wednesday mornings. All of our poop goes in the dumpster. All of our poop goes in the dumpster. And we've got 5-gallon buckets of them. Yep. Next.
That's it?
Oh. My German Shepherd dog is really good remote collar trained, but he still has an intense stare with a cat. What I would do is correct it. Well, there's therapy dogs and then there's service dogs. There's a difference. So I think the person asked for a therapy dog. Emotional support dog. There's a difference between emotional support, therapy, and service. But PTSD does qualify for service dog, I believe. Yep. Either way, there's scams across the board.
Holding E mini remote with three dogs on walk is hard. I can't figure out how to hold in hands with leashes.
Vic, did you get the Easy 900, the 903? Get the 903. You should have the 903. But you should also get the dogs up to correction level where you're not always pushing buttons. You only have to push a button once in a while. So you master it with one dog, then add two, and then add three dogs. Then add three dogs. Okay? Yep. So Corey has a great service dog, Silver Lab PTSD. Yep, good. There are great organizations out there. There are great organizations that are out there, and also you actually can train your own. And there are a lot of now trainers that are getting into it. Just be super, super, super careful. That's all I'm saying. A lot of scams are going on out there. Next.
I think that might be
okay. Cool. Okay, good. All right. Well, it's almost 10 o'clock anyway, so that's fine. If you've been watching this, Corey Michael, do you have any organization you recommend? Oh, cool. Yeah. Bumping into the leg during the walk, what I would do is you can take your leg and walk into the dog. So walk into the dog. So if you heel your dog on the left, what I would do is we walk straight, and then all of a sudden, boom, make a quick turn right into that dog's head. Quick turn. We're talking military turn. Right into that dog. Not a U-turn, but a quick turn. I want the dog to learn how to yield to you. It's called yielding to you. So a lot of times the dog has to learn how to yield to your body. They have no idea about, they've got no idea about space. So your dog is not spatially aware. So that's what I would do. That's what I would do. That is what we do. Everything I recommend, by the way, we do. That's another thing. Being a working dog trainer, traveling the world doing seminars, I only talk about what I do and what works for us. And we've proofed it anywhere from 20 times to 1,000 times. I've got videos on almost every single thing that I talk about. So I practice what I preach and I put it out there for people to see. If I don't know the answer, I will literally tell you, I don't know the answer. That's just how I am. That's just how I am. All right? That's just how I am. So, and yeah, I appreciate all of you. So we're gonna close out the show. It's been a really, really great show. Angelo's got to go to bed. Angelo, say goodbye to your friends. Want to say goodbye to Periscope? Close that up, buddy. All right. So it's been Jeff Gellman of Solid Canine Training. This is Linda. Linda, you gonna do a Periscope tonight? Linda's gonna do a Periscope.
Say that.
Yep.
We don't know if that's true.
Linda needs to do a Periscope. All right. You can't go more than 24 hours without a Periscope. Tomorrow I'll be doing, tomorrow we load up the RV. RV is going to be loaded up by tomorrow night. Tomorrow night, Friday morning, we'll do a tour of the RV. A lot of people are brand new. They haven't even seen the inside of the RV. So we'll do that. And we head up to, Meitner Cast Cone. That's great. We head back up to Rhode Island next weekend. I've got an RV dog training seminar, and we only have three of the dogs. We only have three of the dogs. Some of my dogs are at my training center, and some of my dogs are at my house. See you, Sarah. She's 12. Yeah, we have seven kids. Let's see, the closest kid we have to that is 10. She'll be 11 soon. Yeah, Linda and I, we've got six daughters, and then Angelo. And there's only three of the kids are with us, so. Three dogs, three kids. Two of the dogs are little chihuahuas, though. Two of the dogs are little chihuahuas. And then we've got girl. We started out the trip with more. So, all right. RVdogtrainer.com, solidcaninetraining.com. I'll be doing some more scopes on single topics. I'll be doing a morning motivation one tomorrow morning. What else? I'll do a swimming one with girl tomorrow. Do a parenting Q&A. I don't know about that. We don't know anything about parenting. Please just ask our kids. Thanks. Thank you. All right. And I want to just thank everybody. I feel blessed and honored that I can teach. I also feel blessed and honored that I've got people that want to learn. I also love to learn myself. Every day I'm always doing lots of reading and learning to become better in everything I do. So I think it's great. I think this is a great platform for me. So it's really, really great. All right. So take care, everybody. Everybody have a very fantastic night. And what I want you to do is I want you to train your dogs, hug your kids. And I love you. I really do. Yep. I'm grateful that I'm here. I'm grateful that I'm here and I can share content. All right. Thank you, everybody. Love you too, Gabe.